Hi all, welcome to ESI Cloud Trainings. My name is Shalini Nerella. Let's get started with Telbhumi Atmosphere Basic Training Day 16 session. The agenda plan for today is we'll discuss about API management as part of event-based integration, and we'll then discuss about the different dashboards that are there in Bhumi, namely account dashboard, HTTP status dashboard, and real-time dashboard. Right? So let's get started. So in our last class, we have discussed about services enablement as part of event-based integration. In our class today, we'll discuss about API management. So this API management is built on top of the services enablement. The main purpose of the API management feature is to enable a web service publisher to expose versioned APIs for a logical group of web services. Clear? So this is very, very important. And this web service API consists of a set of REST, SOAP, and or OData endpoints. APIs are implemented as deployable API components. API management allows for web service components to be consolidated into a single explicit location, making API design easier and more efficient. Right? So rather than having multiple listeners at different addresses, API management can organize each operation into one vessel that can be easily consumed by customers and partners. Clear? You might get a doubt. So what is the difference between services enablement and API management? Right? So the main difference is that the API management enables API with customized endpoints, whereas services enablement enables API without customized endpoint. Clear? So then, coming to the life cycle of API management. So it basically works on three major steps: create, publish, and manage. So under create, you can create APIs from new or existing integration processes. And then in publish, you can publish APIs anywhere, on-premise or on cloud. You can provide security capabilities and authentication mechanism for right stakeholders to access the desired data. Clear? And then coming to manage, once the APIs are published, you can centrally manage APIs through traffic control and usage dashboard, right? Coming to the different web services types we have. So we have basic, intermediate, and advanced, right? As we discussed in our last class. So we usually use basic when we want to integrate web services server operation component. And if you want anyone to hit the API or with a specific token that is not user specific, in that case, you'll go for basic. And the available endpoints here are WS Simple and WS SOAP. Coming to the intermediate, the primary use is that when integrating web services server operation component, and if you want only specific users to hit the API, then you'll select intermediate. And available endpoints here are again WS Simple and WS SOAP. And you'll go for advanced when we want to integrate web service component. Right, so then we'll select advanced, and remember the available endpoints here we have are WS SOAP and WS REST. While coming to basic and intermediate, we have WS Simple and WS SOAP. Clear? So now let's try to create an API component. So what we'll do here is, in our last class, we have used complex web services server, right? We have built complex web services server. So we have exposed here it as web services server. Now we'll try to create REST and SOAP endpoints for this complex web services server using API, right? So let's now create a folder by name day 16. And let me create a new component. So under new component, now you'll see here API. So we have API component. So API components are deployable components used to expose sets of REST, SOAP, and or OData endpoints for logical groups of APIs. Clear? So now because we are getting the data from Salesforce and loading it into database, let me call this as Salesforce2 database API, right? So this is how the API component looks like. So here, as discussed, we have REST, SOAP, and OData endpoints. You can configure them. And under General tab, you can provide your API configuration details. So see here, you can provide the metadata, the publisher information, so that other users can view this. So published API title, let me say this SF2DB, and published version number, I'll call this as V1.0. Published description, Salesforce 2 database integration. And under service configuration, you can pass the base API path. So whatever you want to form as the API base API path, you can provide that here. I'll say SF2DB, right? And here you'll have advanced settings. So under advanced settings, you have dynamic document property headers. So the dynamic document property headers whose values in REST and SOAP requests are passed to the API's linked listener processes execution as dynamic document parameters, right? So whatever you had as header name and value over here will go as dynamic document parameters to the linked API processes, right? And remember one thing. So even if you specify them in the header list over here, if they are defined as protected in the Atom shared web server configuration, then they are not sent to the linked processes. Clear? So if they are set as protected in the Atom shared web server configuration, even you specify them over here, they are not sent to the linked processes. This is very important. Right? And also, the dynamic document property name assigned to each passed value has the prefix in header underscore. Say, for example, if you are sending the header name as content type, content hyphen type, so that will be going as in header underscore content hyphen type. So that will go is the dynamic document parameter name for the value of the standard header content hyphen type. Clear? Also, incoming HTTP headers with the special prefix X-WSS- will automatically be passed into the process, and you do not need to specify them in the dynamic document property headers. Here, so even if you don't want to provide them here in the headers, you can still send them to the linked processes by using this prefix saying X-WSS-. Clear? So that's about the advanced settings here. So let me delete this. And coming to the REST tab. So API REST tab is used to generate and configure API's REST endpoints. Endpoint consists of a resource which identifies an object and a route which specifies an operation performed on the object. So here either you can create an endpoint by importing or you can create manually. So because I already have the process, I'll try to import it. So when you import, these are the options that are available to you. Create a new process, import from an external service file, or import from an external service URL, use an existing process, import processes from an environment. So because I already have the process, I'll say use an existing process and say next. So select your process. I'm selecting complex web services server, and I'll add this to REST and SOAP. So OData will see that with a different example. Because OData, the key value should be passed only as a numeric value, which cannot be passed to this process. So we are exposing that as REST and SOAP. Okay. So let's say finish. So see here, your REST configuration can be shown here. This is the path to REST. So see here, it will form WS REST SF2DB, which is the base API path that I provided here. Right, and your endpoint. So this SF name is the endpoint you have got. Clear? And you'll see here actions. So you can either edit endpoint or you can copy to SOAP, OData, and delete this endpoint. So when I say edit endpoint, you'll be able to see the resource path here and the HTTP method. So get is what is inherited from the selected process. Other than that, you have get, post, put, delete. So if you select guest, you can do get or query operations. Post, you can do create, execute, or upset operation. Put, is you can do update operation, and delete is for doing your delete operation. Clear? And coming